Buongiorno a tutti, cari amici di Cultura Emotiva. Oggi sono veramente contento di presentarvi una persona che ho incontrato recentemente grazie a un percorso che sto facendo qui a Milano con Spazio Iris e che è Ronald Siegel. Ronald Siegel, per quelli di voi che non lo conoscessero, è uno psicologo clinico americano che è professore all'Harvard University ed è stato uno dei primi in assoluto a integrare e studiare come poter integrare la mindfulness con la psicoterapia. È oggi autore di numerosi libri sul tema, è sicuramente una delle figure nell'ambito della mindfulness di maggior spicco. Ve lo presenterò a breve. Nel frattempo, insomma, vi ringrazio di essere qua e spero di ricevere da voi dei commenti, delle curiosità. Ok, professore, e la prima domanda che le vorrei porre è: come la mindfulness può aiutare le persone ad affrontare le loro problematiche psicologiche?
I think the way that mindfulness practices help with psychological problems is by addressing the universal factors that are part of almost all psychological distress. Almost all psychological distress involves trying to avoid feeling something which is painful or difficult. If we look at the common difficulties that people have, let's say alcohol or drug use, why do people use drugs or alcohol? Mostly because there's some kind of feeling, some experience, which they're having difficulty tolerating, and they want escape from the pain, so they use the substance in order to escape the pain. We look at things like anxiety, and you know, anxiety disorders are not, the problem is not about feeling anxious or having psychophysiological arousal. The problem is that we're trying not to feel anxious. And it's all the things that people avoid in order to not feel anxious, avoiding public speaking, avoiding driving over bridges, avoiding going to parties. The things people avoid are precise, it is the practice of avoiding things that causes the psychological distress. Even in something like depression, what's happening is the system is shutting down. We're not feeling our full range of feelings. We're not feeling joy. We're not even feeling sadness fully. We're just feeling kind of dead and lifeless. And mindfulness practice tends to work opposite that by helping us to feel more alive, to notice what's going on, and in particular, to approach thoughts and feelings that may be difficult to tolerate. So we see that across a very wide range of different kinds of psychological distress, it's our attempt to not feel discomfort that's at the heart of it. And bit by bit, as we practice mindfulness, we learn how to be with whatever's happening in the heart and mind. And that means being with joy, being with excitement, being with a spirit of adventure and interest, but it also means being with sadness or being with anger or being with frustration or being with fear, and learning that these are simply passing experiences that we can open up to and tolerate. So in a very broad way, mindfulness practices tend to help us move toward the things that are difficult for us, while most forms of psychological distress are about pulling away from what's difficult for us.
Lei è stata una delle prime persone che si è occupata di integrare la pratica di mindfulness con la psicoterapia. Che beneficio porta unire mindfulness e psicoterapia?
Some 35 years ago, my friends and colleagues were a group of people, all who were around the Boston area, many had trained in or were teaching in the Harvard Medical School system. We started investigating how mindfulness practices might enhance psychotherapy and how what we know from psychotherapy and from clinical work as well as from scientific psychology might inform or augment the practices that come from ancient traditions that generated mindfulness practices. And these are both attempts to help people to live richer, fuller lives and to be saner. They come about it from somewhat different perspectives, but those perspectives very much inform one another. And I could mention, this is a vast question, so there are many different ways that they inform one another. But a significant one is that most of our psychological distress involves experiential avoidance, as I mentioned before, trying to get away from difficult feelings, but it also means getting stuck in thought patterns that are not helpful to us. These may be thought patterns that were established when we were children, ways of viewing the world. They could be thought patterns that have been picked up from our culture in some way, particularly if we're a member of an oppressed group of some sort. There are many different thought patterns that are psychologically challenging to us. And most Western psychotherapeutic models try to change those thought patterns. You know, you have cognitive behavior therapy, which is trying to replace irrational, maladaptive thoughts with adaptive, rational ones. Or you have the whole psychodynamic traditions that look for the roots of various ways of looking at the world and looking at yourself and see how that might have been born out of your family or your culture and look how you might transform those. While mindfulness practices approach the same problem from a little bit of a different angle. They do it from the angle of actually practicing stepping below the thought stream and being with moment-to-moment experience in the body so that we can develop what's called metacognitive awareness, the ability to see thoughts as thoughts and not identify with them or believe in them so much. So both of these approaches, for example, are helpful in dealing with thoughts that are problematic. They both mindfulness practices and Western psychotherapeutic approaches have ways of dealing with feeling that are difficult. In most forms of therapy, the safety of the therapeutic relationship allows us to get in contact with feeling, to share it with others, to feel held and supported by the therapist, and this becomes a rich territory for exploring feeling. In mindfulness practice, we do it by staying with feelings as sensations in the body and using the practice of meditation and perhaps the comfort of the breath to allow ourselves to contact feeling. So both methods also allow us to come in contact with a wider range of feeling and to be more comfortable with a wider range. And we could go on for quite some time because there are many, many overlaps between the two because they're both really systems of helping with psychological distress, and psychological distress has had some real commonalities for thousands of years.
La domanda adesso che mi sorge però spontanea è: quali sono le controindicazioni della mindfulness?
We're discovering more and more that mindfulness practices are both, on the one hand, very powerful, but on the other hand, because they're powerful, they can be dangerous, they can be problematic. Pretty much anything that has the power to do great good has the power to do some, to create problems, fire being the obvious example of that. And mindfulness is a little bit like fire this way. We find that people can get themselves into trouble, particularly if people go on silent retreats that don't have a lot of opportunities for processing what's happening, for getting social support, for getting guidance from teachers. What can happen is people can get a few different kinds of problems. One is these practices tend to soften the repression barrier. So all of the thoughts and feelings that we push out of our awareness because they were painful, maybe painful many years ago, maybe painful more recently, all of these contents that are difficult to accept tend to come back into our awareness when we practice mindfulness, when we're no longer distracting ourselves with our smartphones or distracting ourselves with some goal-oriented behavior. Everything we've pushed away comes back. As one of my patients put it so nicely, when we bury feelings, we bury them alive, and they come back. So if a person's not ready to reintegrate this material, well, then the practices can be overwhelming to them. Another way that practices can be difficult is that these practices tend to make us reconsider or even deconstruct our conventional sense of self. They help us to see that the stories we tell about who we are, the narratives we have about ourselves, are pretty arbitrary and they're pretty culturally conditioned. And as we stay moment to moment with experiences in the body, and as we practice stepping out of the thought stream, we start to feel a sense of interrelatedness with other people, with all beings. We start to see how we create stories about ourselves and how we create a sense of separateness out of these narratives. That's potentially very liberating. It can make us feel, become free of self-esteem concerns. It can connect us to others in beautiful ways. It can bring transformative spiritual experiences. But it can also be quite unsettling when people start to feel, wait a minute, I don't know who I am anymore, or who am I if I'm not my thoughts and my goals and my beliefs? So this can be upsetting and destabilizing to people. The general approach, therefore, that we need to take is whenever people are learning mindfulness practices, to do it in a safe environment where there are other people that they can talk to, and particularly where folks are invited to report on their experience and let teachers know what they're experiencing, where they're having difficulty, so they can get support with it, and perhaps so that they could change and try different practices that would be more suited to them at this moment.
Ecco, esatto. A tal proposito, quando lavoriamo con dei casi difficili, quali sono le linee guida che come psicoterapeuti dobbiamo tenere a mente per poter usare in maniera corretta la pratica di mindfulness in psicoterapia?
There's a few guidelines that I think we should consider. One is, how comfortable is a person going to be with mindfulness practice? Some people come from cultural backgrounds where they think, oh, that's Buddhist and that's against my religious tradition, or that's religious or spiritual and I'm a secular person. So we need to present the practices in a way that people are going to be able to feel comfortable with, that fits their language and their culture. Another consideration is how comfortable the person is with their inner experience. If somebody has been distracting themselves their whole life from their feelings and trying to push thoughts out of awareness, they're likely to become overwhelmed very quickly if we invite them to just be quiet, be with the experience of the body, and stay with it. So people need to be eased into it. Folks have different kinds of attention spans. If we're dealing with children, for example, we need exercises that are quite short and that have very vivid objects of awareness so that people are working with things that are easy to feel, you know, touching smooth stones or observing a picture or listening to music or bells or sounds. For some people, you need a more vivid, clearer object of awareness to make it easier to pay attention to. And the overarching issue that we have to pay attention to is, will a person be overwhelmed by what happens? Will a person feel like, oh my gosh, I'm losing my conventional sense of self, this is frightening? Or will a person start to remember trauma that's been pushed out of their awareness? And if that's the case, we need to be there therapeutically and have other therapeutic tools outside of mindfulness to use to help them with their growth and development.
Ok, adesso volevo proporre un argomento che so che a lei è molto caro. Che cos'è la compassione e come può aiutare le persone a regolare, a gestire in qualche modo le loro problematiche?
As human beings, we have both a head and a heart. And if we're going to help people move towards psychological health, we have to both address their cognitive processes, the way in which they see the world, and we have to address their emotional experience. Compassion refers to the human capacity to suffer with another person. When we see somebody in pain, we have the capacity to feel their pain and to have a wish to ameliorate their pain. And this compassion is very easy to feel toward others that we think of as innocent. Parents feel compassion toward their children when their children are hurt. For some individuals, it's very easy to feel compassion. Of course, if we start to think of somebody as a bad person or we're frightened by somebody, it's much more difficult to experience compassion toward them. And compassion works in two directions. There's both compassion that we have for others as well as compassion that we develop for ourselves. Very often we're in pain ourselves, we're struggling in some way, and finding a way to self-soothe, finding a way to take care of ourselves, to make ourselves feel held and loved, can be a very important part of feeling, of healing. What it's really doing is it's reproducing the attachment relationship that maybe we had as a child or maybe we didn't have as a child, but introducing the same feelings of secure attachment that would come normally in a good developmental trajectory. And we can generate this by deliberately cultivating compassion. And there's a wide variety of compassion exercises, most of which involve generating a feeling of love and kindness, identifying some kind of hurt that another person is experiencing, and in some way sending that other person good wishes, or doing the same for ourselves, sending ourselves good wishes. And this provides a kind of holding environment, a kind of hug, if you will, that allows us to heal from psychological hurts.
Ho una domanda su un argomento che io ho molto a cuore. Ha mai praticato la mindfulness relazionale, come può essere l'insight dialogue o la core process psychotherapy? E se sì, non ritiene che questo modello di mindfulness possa essere molto interessante dal punto di vista dell'integrazione tra pratiche di mindfulness e psicoterapia?
Absolutely. I am more familiar with insight dialogue than I am of the other method that you mentioned that I'm not familiar with. But I've participated in insight dialogue workshops from time to time. And the idea of being mindful of what's happening in oneself, what's happening in the other, and particularly being mindful of the flow of the interpersonal field can be of great assistance in psychotherapy, because we know from psychotherapy outcome research that it's when our patients are feeling held, when they feel understood, when they feel that we're warm, empathic, and understanding, they grow, they get better. And if we have a sense of being able to feel when the interpersonal field is safe, is connected, and we're having mutual understanding, or as my friend and colleague Dan Siegel says, when the patient feels felt by us, if we are attuned to that, we're going to be much more effective as psychotherapists. And many of the interpersonal mindfulness practices, I think, are exquisite ways to help us develop that kind of attunement.
Ora una domanda un po' provocatoria. Sembra che ci siano dei principi buddhisti che suggeriscono che il nostro libero arbitrio sia in realtà molto limitato e che il nostro sé sia in realtà un costrutto illusorio, una percezione illusoria. Cosa ci può dire a riguardo? Qual è la sua opinione in merito?
Well, concepts like free will have been debated by philosophers for centuries, and trying to understand what our sense of self is about has also been debated, and different philosophic, religious, cultural systems view these things differently. My own understanding of this gets pretty close to the Buddhist understanding of it. It seems to me that our sense of self is created out of all of the reflections that we get throughout a lifetime. All of the times that we interact with other people who treat us in a certain way, who either think we're wonderful or terrible, who tell us that we have this quality or that quality, we start to assume, oh, that's who I am. There is a fellow by the name of Cooley, who's one of the first social psychologists. He wrote around 1900 or so, and he coined the term the looking glass self. Looking glass in this meaning is holding a mirror up. And it's, he says, we develop a sense of self from all of the mirrored images that we have throughout a lifetime. And it seems to me that that's what's happening. And when I do mindfulness practice, I notice, I don't find the self in there. I simply see the never-ending, well, it's not never-ending, it'll end when I die, but the currently never-ending kaleidoscope of thoughts, images, sensations, emotions, coming and going constantly. There doesn't seem to be anything steady. There doesn't seem to be a central, solid core that I would call a sense of self. So my sense of who this organism is very much in line with how Buddhist traditions tend to describe it. Now that said, I of course react like anybody else, you know. You take my money and wait, it's mine, you know, give that back to me. You know, you love me, I think I'm wonderful. Thank you for loving me. And you know, I have all the human reactions that anybody else does, but when I step back and reflect on it, I do notice that these are impersonal events happening in the mind-body. As to free will, this is interesting. It certainly feels as though we have free will. When I say right now, I'm gonna raise my left hand and I do it, that seems like it came from free will. But if I really were to examine it, I'd say, well, what are all the factors and forces that made that thought appear in my mind? In fact, I didn't create that thought. That thought, oh, maybe I should raise my hand, appeared in the screen of consciousness, and then the decision happened to do it. I'm not sure there was an I doing any of that, even though subjectively, of course, it feels like I did that. So this is a very interesting area, I think. And therapeutically, it's most helpful in that it can really help to free us from blaming others and blaming ourselves. If we start to realize that we are all just these unfolding conditioned organisms, it's quite helpful for relaxing a little bit and having more acceptance for our experience.
Grazie mille, dottor Siegel. Grazie per queste due giornate che ho speso molto volentieri qui a Spazio Iris. E ringrazio anche voi ascoltatori, mi auguro di potervi presentare nuove interviste a breve con altri personaggi di spicco che possano supportarci nel fare cultura nel nostro ambito, che è quello della psicologia.